is a first. It is actually our first year as Roswell Met, as well as our first debate. So please bear with us as we work through some of the kinks. I know we tried our best to accommodate all the candidates, their schedules and such, and we appreciate their attendance tonight. I'd like to take a few minutes tonight, before we get into the debates, to go over our agenda and answer the question, what is Roswell Met? Roswell Next is focused on providing the dialogue between local citizens and council and mayor. So we are focused on three pillars: social, economic development, and civic. Within those three pillars, we are hopefully going to provide a better foundation underpinned by those three items. With that, over the past year, we've held three town halls. I think some of you have attended those, as well as we've had our informal What's Next Roswell. It's basically an informal gathering of citizens at one of Roswell's many restaurants. Within that, we've made numerous networking connections, as well as connected people with local government officials to, again, open the dialogue between local Roswell resident and council and mayor. Secondly, we'd like to thank High Meadows School for hosting this wonderful debate. I'd like to give High Meadows a round of applause. Thank you. Now getting into just a brief overview of the evening. Before I get into that though, I'd like some housekeeping items. For safety, there are exits on the corners of the building, and for your convenience, there are restrooms to your left. With that, we are going to then start with the introductions. Jay, I'm going to call Jay Underwood up. He is the head of the school. Jay.
Well, thank you for joining us here at High Meadows for our first involvement and what I hope is not the last involvement with Roswell Next. And hosting our city council candidates here is a great honor for High Meadows. We've been here in Roswell for 40 years, and I know that many of you may not have known that. Some of you don't have the occasion to drive down this lane of Willeo, but we have been a big part of this community for 40 years. We employ 80 people year-round, and we also have a big summer camp, which is one of the largest in Atlanta. And so we're very proud to provide the services we do for students in North Fulton and East Cobb. We're an independent preschool through eighth grade. We are a globally focused, child-centered school, very unusual, terrific approach to education, international baccalaureate school, which means the kinds of approaches that we have are really focused on students engaging with the global society today. And I hope and believe that we can continue to be an active member, not only in Roswell's development, but also in North Fulton, East Cobb, and the whole Atlanta area's involvement in creating a great educational future for our children. We have lots of community events here, this being one of them. So we invite you to come to our farmers market in the spring. Other events that we have throughout the year, I hope you'll keep your eyes out and listen for great opportunities to come back and visit us. Of course, those of you who have young children, we always are happy to welcome you to visit the school, and we hope that you will. So it's my pleasure to introduce someone who has been involved with High Meadows School for almost as long as it's been in operation. His mother, Tilly, was our first kindergarten teacher. He himself was a board member and a member, and actually the chair of the board at High Meadows some years ago. He was very instrumental as well in being one of the people who helped us with an Amish-type barn raising of our barn theater, which is still in existence today. And he happens also to be the mayor of Roswell. So it's my pleasure to introduce Mayor Jere.
Vision for Roswell. So I tried to project out 20 years of what you can expect in Roswell. And although this vision is based upon my hopes, it's also backed up by existing plans, and it's supported by Roswell's history. So I think I'm fairly confident that we're going to achieve this vision. I want to start with what really makes a city great. It's good citizens. It's not land use plans, it's not zoning. It's not developers. Schools have a big part to do with it. But it's good citizens, and schools have a big part to play in raising those good citizens. Roswell, in the last 10 years, has been growing around 1% a year. I expect it'll continue on that pace. Some folks talk about how Roswell is going to see skyscrapers. Don't see it. Only see about a 1% growth per year. Some folks have talked about UDC and how it's going to totally change Roswell. That's not our history. That's not where we're going. So if we continue to grow at that 1% a year in 20 years out, we'll probably be going from about 90,000 to about 110,000. There'll be a little more traffic, there'll be a little more people, but I think that's going to be overall a good thing. I think we're going to retain our good citizens, and we're going to attract great new citizens, some of which we're going to raise and educate, and will stay here and grow up in Washington. So in 20 years, I expect to have more good citizens with even more talent and energy and creativity than we have today. And I think with more good citizens, our churches, our synagogues, our schools, and our civic institutions will be strengthened and will experience a growth in art and culture in Roswell and will become an even better place to live. Now I want to talk about some of the specifics you can expect to see over the next 20 years. One thing, talking about government, I'm confident we're going to see a Milton County in the next 20 years. And I'm also confident that some of the people that are sitting in this audience and some of the people that are serving with NEXT today will be serving as our elected mayor and council the next 20 years. I don't expect to be there in 20 years. I expect to see some new blood and some new energy on the council. But as far as, I want to talk about the changes, because I think you're going to see less change. You're going to see more of this familiar in the future than the changes, but I really want to focus on the changes. What are you going to see that's going to change in the next 20 years? By and large, you're not going to see our single family neighborhoods change. That's the large majority of the land area in Roswell. Our single family neighborhoods are not going to change. We haven't seen the change in the last 20 years. We've seen growth, but we're not going to see those develop into something else. I expect to see more neighborhoods, more sidewalks in those neighborhoods and some infill development, but I expect the houses will be the same size and the same square footage and the same size lots as we see today. So in your neighborhood, I do not expect to see any change. In our parks, I expect to see little change. One of the good things when we brought in these artificial turf fields, and we were afraid as a city where it was going to grow, we're going to have to clear a lot of this land for more ball fields. We're getting a lot more use on those artificial turf fields. So we'll be able to have as many people playing on fields and get a lot more use out of the fields we do. So I see most of our parks are going to see little change. The biggest change in our recreation department is folks like me getting older. We're going to see more and more programs for seniors. We've already got a huge list of programs, but for many of you in the audience, you're going to have even more programs at Roswell Rec. The biggest change in our parks is going to be down at the Chattahoochee River. We're getting a bicycle pedestrian bridge across the Chattahoochee. In Cobb County, they brought in bike lanes along Lower Roswell Road, so expect to see more bicycles in Roswell. I see that as a good thing. The biggest change is that the A Sand Company property, where there's a sand plant now, we're in the process of doing a master plan. I expect to see more volleyball courts, more food trucks, more pavilions. And I encourage you, if you've got some ideas of what you'd like to see on the river, to participate in the upcoming master plan, because we want to know what you want to see on the river. So that's where the biggest change I see in our parks is down at the riverfront, because there's been a recognition that we need to really bring that river along and focus on that river. The only place I think you'll really see any changes is in our commercial corridors, and most of them I don't think you're going to see that much change. Parkway Village, 92 east of Highway 9. In the neighborhood I grew up in, don't really, that's our newest development. I don't expect to see any real changes there. Alpharetta Highway, north of Holcomb Bridge Road, where our auto sales district. Don't expect to see any change there other than the car lots seem building, new car lots are changing. So I expect that the sign out front will change and the cars will change, but that's our auto sales district. Holcomb Ridge Road, east of Old Alabama. I hope to see a lot of pedestrian improvements over on that side of town. We've got a new library going in. We've got, I hope to create a pedestrian connection between the Centennial property and the park and the library and the river to get people across there. So I hope to see a lot of pedestrian improvements. In the long run, I think you're going to see some more mixed-use development in some of all those old shopping centers. But I expect to see that. No real changes in the neighborhoods. South Atlanta Street, from the river up to the square, you're going to see four lanes instead of three. Councilmember Price and I went and talked to the governor's office to try to find that money, and we're looking at a right-of-way acquisition right now. And we hope in the next few years to see that suicide lane eliminated. Four lanes, but not a lot more changes to that street. The biggest changes are going to be in the historic district and the 400 Holcomb Ridge Road interchange. The historic district, I think, is going to become not just our historic district, but it's going to continue building on success, become an entertainment, art, and cultural district. We're going to see more restaurants. We're going to see new entertainment venues. We're going to see public art. We're going to see walkable neighborhoods. We're going to see new streets. We're talking about extending Webb Street. And I'm thinking there's discussion of, we don't have a name for it, but it's a new Canton Street, a sort of a Canton Street between the new City Hall Green and the old mill. So I expect to see some new streets in the historic district and a total upgrading of roadways. So you're going to see walkable communities in the historic district. And then that gets to the intersection of 400 and Holcomb Ridge Road, where there are old apartments. I expect in 20 years we'll see something different. I don't know what's going to be there. There's no consensus on what that's going to be developed as. But we're going to see probably in the next 20 years two hot lanes either way on 400. So we'll see another four lanes on 400 probably in the next 20 years. We'll see a new Big Creek Bridge over 400 connecting east and west Roswell. We'll probably see a MARTA station at that intersection. My guess, we'll see close to $100 million in transportation improvements if you count MARTA at that intersection. And that's going to drive change, and this community needs to make a decision of what that change needs to be. I cannot tell you what it's going to be, but I do not expect it to be old apartments in 20 years with $100 million spent on transportation improvements. Having said all of that, I think these changes will make Roswell an even better place to live. It'll bring more good jobs to Roswell. It'll bring that most essential element to all cities, good citizens, to the city of Roswell. And I think that would be good for all of us. Looking back, I think the historians will describe this era as Roswell's second golden age. I see the first golden age is when Barrington King lived here. But I believe this is the time when the foundations are being laid to change Roswell from a bedroom community into a world-class place for people of all kinds and all ages to live. So I see that now is the most exciting time in Roswell. It's good to have you as part of it. It's good to see the leadership and the voters of Roswell here. Get out and vote. Thank you for having me.
Please give them a round of applause for putting on this event. And secondly, we have a table off to the side. If you want more information on Roswell Next, please put down your name and email address. Otherwise, you can check out our website, roswellnext.org. With that, let me give you an overview of how tonight we'll go, and then we'll get into it. So we are going to start off with stump speech of 2 minutes. Each candidate will have 2 minutes to give a stump speech, and then we'll get into the questions. Each question has a 1 minute response. There is a rebuttal to that question at 1 minute, and then a redirect at another minute. All total, I should have you out of here in about 75 minutes, so catch your show in a few minutes. With that, I'm actually going to turn it over and we're going to start the debate. So the first question is going toward, the stump speech is going to go by official coin toss to Kent. Kent, as part of your introduction and speech, would you please address the following? What drives your desire or continued desire for public office? What city projects or initiatives matter most to you? And how will you become more effective on council than your competitor?
In 2 minutes, right? Well, let me toss out everything I was thinking of saying. Which first, of course, is thanks to High Meadows and for Roswell for putting all this together, because obviously there's a great turnout, so this is something that's needed. And I would like to start on things I think that we all agree on. You know, as the mayor said, we've got a great place to live, we've got great people who live here, so there's no question about that. I think we also agree that there are areas that we need to work on. There are some blighted areas. We all know our shopping centers and some of the used car lots and some of the apartments that are issues. I think all want to look at things that can change some of that and make things mixed use and some of the things that the mayor just talked about. But the three questions I come up with are, well, where do we want to do things, how fast do we want to do things, and how much do we want? And that's been my approach through council and through involvement through HOAs previously. I think we need to be careful about how we do those things and look at the areas that need to be focused just on where we have problems right now, those blighted areas. So that's been my focus. That's what I put together as a vision that I don't have time to get into right this second, but working on those areas and making them things that we want to be, the walkable communities we talk about. And as I've heard folks with Roswell next say, Cant Street is a great place. Let's do that elsewhere. But we need to look at how much we do allow, because if you allow 4-6 stories and all kinds of stuff in there, that's not what Cant Street is. And so let's look at allowing more of what we actually want, and that's how we'll get what we want. So that is the kind of focus I've had. As you've heard, probably one of the things, I do think the devil is in the details, because this is our zoning code, and we have to figure out what works for everybody. And so that is a challenge. I have focused on that kind of thing for a long time. That is how we're going to move forward. And boy, two minutes is tough to put all that together. I'm not sure I got all of your points, but we'll let Harvey try to see how you can do it.
Turn it over to Harvey.
Okay. Thank you, Aaron. So, same question for me, or?
Yeah, just please address in your stump speech if you will. Do you want me to repeat them?
Please do.
Okay. What drives your desire or continued desire for public office? What city projects or initiatives matter most to you? Or how will you become more effective on council than your competitor?
Well, first of all, what's driven me to run for this office is I want to pay back this community that has been so good to me and my family over the last 26 years. I've given much thought to some of the areas that, as far as what I would like to accomplish would be to preserve, your home values. I would like to promote businesses, small businesses, or, that's important to our economy. I would like to, come up with solutions or be involved with dialogue that comes up with viable solutions for our traffic concerns. The reason I think, I would do a better job than my opponent is I'm a small business owner. I've been involved in the community. I know what it takes to come up with solutions, how to work with other people, how to think outside the box, because I've been through four very severe, or the last economic downturn has probably been one of the worst we've gone through in the real estate world, and I don't know all the answers, but I'm going to work hard. I'm going to be present at all events. I will attend all the city functions that I need to be at, and I'll be responsive to my constituents. If you email me or call me at nighttime, I'll promise to return a call or email within 24 hours. And I think that's part of the job, and that's my commitment to you.
Thank you. See you in the early. No, we're gonna keep it on you, and now actually ask the first question.
Okay.
Wait till the official timekeeper is ready. Okay. So prior to the question, there's a little bit of context to the question. The Atlanta Beltline is becoming a national model of redevelopment by creating new trails, green spaces, and affordable housing while acting as a catalyst for private redevelopment in blighted areas. Roswell has its own unique plan for trail interconnectivity throughout the city called the Roswell Loop. Here's the question. Would you support allocating dollars and resources to completing the Roswell Loop to increase walkability, bikeability, and overall community connectivity? Why or why not?
Good question. I would like to look at the impact it would have as far as the dollars, the amount of dollars that would be required to connect it. I think it's something that we want. Anything that will get more cars off the road right now, I think is the Beltway project. But anything, I would support any kind of movement that would get people out of their cars, protected bikeways, protected paths. That would be a good thing, but I would have to look at what that would entail as far as, whether or not I would support the budget, how much money would be involved there. But it's definitely something that I would consider.
Board response?
Yes. A little bit more than that since I have time.
Redirect.
Hey. Yes, I do support that. I do think that it is a long-term project, no question, so it's not all the money at one time, but it's something that I think is a vision for the city that can be a catalyst for development. Not in the same way that the Beltline is, because it has many more things to it, but I think it does add amenity to those who live in communities that aren't down by the river, because obviously we do have trails in certain specific places, but having that loop really expands it all throughout the city of Roswell. Again, it's not going to be an overnight, even a short-term project. It will take probably the 20 years more, maybe, that the mayor said. Those dollars have to be put over time. We may look at the possibility of some bonds over time to increase that if we need to. But yes, no question that we need to do that, and I support it and would support funding for it.
Harvey, any redirect?
I guess not only as far as redirecting the thought process, I would, my feeling would be that it would be something that, I want to further that by expanding to, pedestrian plazas or any type of, non-motorized mode of transportation that would enhance, the movement through the city. But really, I think that's something that's been very popular throughout the city. I mean, I think we're conducive to that. We would want to see that happen, but I think we would need more information on exactly what the cost would be and what areas it would affect.
Thank you. All right, so next question to Kent. Keeping with the walkability and bikeability theme, research shows that millennials and boomers are looking for a more walkable and bikeable place to live. They're looking at city centers and suburban town centers in large numbers and driving demand in those areas. This trend is expected to continue for the next 15 to 20 years as supply of walkable places catches up to the demand. Here's the question. How do you define a walkable, bikeable place, and will the UDC help Roswell keep up with the demand? Why or why not?
Well, I guess it's a generic description of that, but allows you to be able to walk and bike to all the things that you need to go to. Unfortunately, I don't think that's realistic anytime, even in the short or mid-range, all the things we're even talking about building or hope to see. You've still got to get other places to work and eat and do other things. Now, can we group a lot of that in some similar places? Sure. And I think the UDC has the elements to be able to start that. My concern is that it spreads it too far. If you actually want to have a walkable community and do things that need to be fairly concentrated areas, and if we allow development in as many places as I think it's being looked at, I don't know that that's going to generate the walkable community. It will actually spread things out, have more stuff that ultimately will create more traffic. So we need to look at the elements that are part of that and how to make that work for specific areas.
Thank you. rebuttal?
Yes, sir. You know, actually, that's one of the biggest differences. The old code that was based over the last 40 years, it was based on the premise that if it was a different use, we needed to keep those different uses far apart. And that's how the UDC is significantly different from that old code. That's one of the reasons we're looking at the UDC, because we want to enhance walkability. It is not going to spread everything out. We're trying to correct the sins of the past. Those old ideas, by having a shopping center away from residential, force you to get in a car and drive to that location. UDC is going to promote areas that are based on your input, citizens' input. It was not what council and mayor and consultants put together. The whole UDC was based on, you know, over 45, 50 public hearings, just like the Strategic Economic Development Plan, the Groveway Community. It was all based on public input. And so it's really going to be based on your ideas, but I mean, that's exactly, I mean, that's totally an incorrect assessment.
Not to cut you off, sorry. Redirect?
I think I like this redirect thing. To clarify what I said, the UDC actually allows a large area, at least what we're looking at in the map, for some of the elements to be applied, in a pretty large area going all the way along our corridors, which, you know, those need to be focused areas, but if you're moving beyond where the blight areas are that we say we want to fix, there are quite a few areas that have one house on 5 acres, not much on a couple acres, and you can easily go there, and I think developers will, because it's easier to do that than some of the areas where we need. I think it can generate something that we have all over. We've added more than what we have now without having the benefits that we're talking about of being walkable. And so if you have 10 of those in spread out areas, then I think you may have a little walkability in a little place, but you'll still, because people still drive cars, you're going to have the same problem but have only added to those. So again, I think we need to focus the efforts of what that creates.
Thank you. Actually, next question is, second question is for Harvey. Sticking with a connectivity theme, but a little bit different. MARTA. MARTA's Connect 400 plan has outlined three alternatives for future MARTA expansion into North Colton up to Windward Parkway. Three alternatives are bus rapid transit, light rail, and heavy rail. Heavy rail would be an extension of the existing red line from North Springs, heavy rail being the most expensive option. If heavy rail were to expand up to north to Georgia 400 Holcomb Bridge area, that would be a stop. Here's the question. Are you in favor of a heavy rail expansion into North Colton? Why or why not?
Not exactly. I'm in favor of looking at the infrastructure that we have in place now with MARTA. I'm for MARTA in the respect that anything that we can do through rapid transit to alleviate traffic that we have and get cars off the road, I'm for that. You know, as that public body that, you know, whether they're efficient or not, I don't know that I would, I'm not going to sit here and advocate that we, you know, they would need to spend more money. I'm for looking at different options that would include working with other public officials, elected officials through MARTA, through you know, the Georgia Regional Transportation Act, through Gwinnett County, through Cobb County, that would improve you know, transportation in our area. I don't think it's just a matter or a concept of adding another hard rail or, you know, bus lines or spending more money on infrastructure. I think we've got the ability right now just to work with the infrastructure that we have.
Thank you.
Well, I see Senator Albert in the back, and he will have to help us on how things happen with MARTA, because they will make the decisions. We will have to work with what that ultimate decision is. The problem with MARTA, I think, is once you get on the train and you get to wherever or move towards to where you're going, how do you then get to your ultimate destination? You can get, obviously, where it goes, but there's most places that it doesn't go without having to get on a bus and change that suit several times. So I don't know that that is the solution for you know, what our issues are at this point. I do think we need to invest in infrastructure, because traffic is coming. no matter what we do, hopefully some of the projects we can look at can help with that. But you know, everybody's building around us, and we will continue to increase density here from everything that's being said. So we have to look at that. But can we widen our roads? No, we can't. We need to deal with different aspects of boy, this 1 minute thing is tough, isn't it? to figure that out. But we have to invest. There's no question.
Thank you. Any rebuttal?
I just thought that was some of the birds up here behind Meadows. You know, again, I think it's not an easy solution, but it is one that we need to investigate. I think it's more of an issue right now in the short term of working with the elected public officials from all bodies. I think we have infrastructure, we have buses, we have trains that are we're just not fully utilizing what we have before us. And I think there's some political options that we should investigate first.
Thank you. All right, so Ken, your second and last question, housing options. What are your thoughts on real, tangible solutions for affordable and workforce housing options? I'm not talking about government subsidized housing. What are your solutions for this type of housing in Roswell? In addition to that, please comment on that, how the Groveway zoning helps or hinders this solution.
Well, we have the Roswell Housing Authority. Now you're talking about not doing public subsidized, but what the plan for that area is to do a whole new project that is mixed income, so it would actually have some very high value elements to that, but then also does have a lower affordable. Because frankly, the number of projects we see, and I think that we will continue to see in Roswell, those are going to be high value, even if they are on small lots. I've never questioned the actual value of those projects and how it impacts property values. They're going to be high cost, so it's not going to be affordable. But if we do look at some of our mixed-use possibilities that I mentioned, I think you can intersperse some of the more affordable housing within that. But I don't believe we need to make major changes to have huge apartments to come replace what we have, because we only have a problem later in the future. But I think we can make those to be, again, the mixed income as well as mixed use, and have a piece of that that can be affordable.
Could you repeat the question, please?
Sure. What are your thoughts on real, tangible solutions for affordable and workforce housing options? And we're not talking about government subsidized in Roswell. Please comment on how the Groveway zoning helps or hinders your proposed solution.
Well, the Groveway community, it was based on, that was one of the intentions, to create more affordable housing for our workforce, not just through subsidized housing, but as a result of having mixed income and the mixed use, you're going to provide an opportunity to have more affordable housing there without it being subsidized. I know that sounds like a kind of like a paradox, but I think when it is put in place, you're not going to have the public housing won't be there any longer, not in the same form or fashion that you see it. But I think under the Roswell Housing Authority, or some of the concepts that I've seen put forth, I think that will promote more affordable housing as a result of that redevelopment that is a positive redevelopment.
Thank you.
That was the part I missed with Groveway. The first project we approved is apartments that they're looking at, a one-bedroom studio for at least $1,000 a month. I don't see that being affordable for a single person to live in. So I'm not sure what we hope for is not necessarily what we get unless we plan it carefully. I'm not talking about doing, you know, government planning stuff, but we need to also look at some of those elements. We did not put any kind of, we only put an encouragement for affordable housing into the Groveway plan. I think Dave will have to tell us the project they're building now with townhomes is going to be, you know, a higher dollar number. The project that we hope will ultimately take place where the Housing Authority is now would have some of that, because that is required. But it is a tough issue, because with the land values we've got, you know, how can we make that part of the ultimate project? I think we need to recruit folks, developers and builders, who can come in and do that kind of thing, because most will not. But we have to deal with that. And Groveway, I'm afraid, doesn't, as it stands now, encourage that.
Okay. Now I'm going to move over to post five, Jere, Orlans, and Eric Schumacher. Kendra, I'm going to start off the same way. Ask you part of your introduction or stump speech. We'd like to answer, like you to answer the following. What drives your desire or continued desire for public office? What city projects or initiatives matter most to you? And how would you become more effective on council than your competitor?
Okay, my name is Eric Schumacher. I'm running for post five. I decided to run for city council after going to a lot of meetings and seeing an opportunity to effect some change at the city. I went to a lot of meetings and felt that my voice wasn't really heard and that decisions had already been made before this council meeting started. Over the last few weeks, I've been campaigning into about 500 homes, and I'm hearing the same message. And it's really confirming for me that we really need more transparency at the city level. We really need to open up our city council to really involve our citizens and really listen to what they have to say. I felt compelled to run. I can be more effective than Jere. Jere's a nice man. My first time in city council, after the meeting, he gave me some chocolates out of his pocket, and I really appreciated that. After several hours of meeting, I really think that we can be more efficient. My day job is quality assurance, and I know how to handle large projects and ensure that those projects have transparency, that we have checks and balances, that we don't make mistakes, that we can mitigate our risks. And the UDC is a great initiative. It can really help us create a toolbox of things that we can do for the city, how we can incentivize change in some of our blight areas, how we can do some exciting projects around 400. We really need to address traffic before we do that. Everybody I talk to says, we cannot handle any more density, our traffic is terrible. So I really do propose that we get the code right and then take an iterative approach to changing our zoning. We're giving zoning incentives to redevelop some of our blight areas before releasing those zoning rules elsewhere. Thank you. Jere?
I'm Jere Orlans, and I'm running for re-election to Roswell City Council. I originally moved to Roswell in the mid-80s, started coaching soccer, and quickly learned to appreciate our great parks department and the opportunities we have for kids and families in the city of Roswell. My desire to be part of the community pushed me to attend city council meetings probably 4 years before I was even elected. So I got involved, learned about the city, and tried to see how I could benefit. I just wanted to keep it a more healthy, vibrant city in which my wife Brenda and I could raise our children. Then in 1997, when I left corporate business and opened up my own office, of course I located in Roswell, right up on Crossville Road. I think my ability to stay close to the citizens by working here, my office is here, of course we all live here, and involved in the community have helped me be able to understand what some of the concerns are, the fact that they want to keep our quality of life, our natural resources protected, and keep that small town atmosphere. And I've worked hard over the years, even though we've been a suburb of Atlanta, to keep that small town atmosphere. It's just a place to gather, like Cannon Street. With excellent schools, tremendous quality of life, and the kind of growth that, controlled growth that we're looking at, I think we're headed in the right direction. I think Roswell has maintained a AAA bond rating for financial stability. I think having the experience of being on the city council, being in business, being accessible in the city, attending a lot of events, being on the board of North Fulton Hospital, the YMCA, Community Foundation of North Fulton, Rotary, and helping out many of our nonprofits, I think I try to be connected and involved in the city. And these are some of the reasons that I want to continue on, because a lot of projects are in place that I can't even touch on in 2 minutes.
We have to cut you off. Apologies. Well, we're going to stay with you, though. We're going to ask you the first question. Public art contributes to urban design revitalization, enhances public spaces, and inspires civic dialogue. Here's the question. Please demonstrate your understanding of the value of public art and state your voting position on passing a comprehensive public art master plan and policy for Roswell.
Other than saying I think it's a great idea and a wonderful direction, and I think we're already starting headed that way. We were traveling in Europe a few months back this summer, and there's a lot of public art over there. Took some pictures, and then I know the Roswell Arts Commission been working with them over the last year. Now I was originally involved in getting the Cultural Arts Board set up. And I think we've got it going in a much, much better direction. We've got some great people on that board right now. And we've got some particular people that are really enthusiastic and pushing for it. So I think it's just another wonderful amenity to try to help keep that community feeling, that small town atmosphere, but bringing in the culture the way we did with the auditorium to try to give us places to have plays and events that we don't have to drive to Atlanta. Same reason I started the July 4th fireworks. I said, why should we drive to Perimeter Mall?
Jere, I'm about to cut you off. Response?
Can you repeat the question?
Of course. Start from the beginning. Public art contributes to urban design, revitalization, enhances public spaces, and inspires civic dialogue. Question. Please demonstrate your understanding of the value of public art and state your voting position on passing a comprehensive public art master plan and policy for Roswell.
Oh, that's great. So I don't know if everybody knows, but I actually have a degree in fine art and photography. So I actually know firsthand why it's important to have art in our community. And I also know it's a top sell for a lot of people because art's expensive, right? And you can't really quantify it like you can a road. You can't really say, this sculpture on this corner is worth X amount to our city. But it really truly does matter. I want to live in a place that is aesthetically beautiful and contributes to our culture. I love public art. I love sculpture. I would love to see us have something in the UBC, for instance, that would do an exchange for public art, public spaces. Beautiful architecture, interesting, the bridge over Chattahoochee with the bike path. I'd love for us to do something there that's artful instead of utilitarian. Of course, we need to do utilitarian first, but I want to see something artful. So I'm very much pro.
To cut you off, apologies. Jere, for rebuttal, and may I ask that you hold your microphone just a little bit further away?
I definitely don't have a degree in art. I've got a degree in finance. But I know when people know art and when people are passionate about it. And I think we've got many different sets of people and citizens that are volunteering their time right now in Roswell to move us forward in this direction. I was just talking to a gentleman yesterday. He wants to bring in a place that has a coffee shop, display art, and have a gathering place. And so I'm trying to put him in touch with our commission to try to go forward with these kind of ideas. So I think there's a lot of potential there. Again, I admire it, and I would love it, and I'd like to have it everywhere in Roswell.
Next question is going to go to Eric. Roswell is plagued by many empty, outdated strip retail spaces. One of the UDC's stated purposes is to help enable revitalization of these areas. Question. Given the realities of the cost of real estate and redevelopment, what do you feel is appropriate usage of empty and outdated strip retail spaces? And how does that agree with, or differ from the UDC?
So, I live on Prospect Street, and the county is actually seen to use the blighted shopping center at the end of my street on Highway 9 for a school. I think that's a fantastic use for a blighted shopping center. The UDC is an opportunity to give zoning incentives to entice these owners to do something else with their shopping centers. I think we have an opportunity there to do that, but I think we need to take an iterative approach, right? We need to focus on just those shopping centers first, I believe. A lot of them have gotten to be blighted because of the ingress-egress issue, so transportation, from my perspective, needs to be addressed first. And if we have developers spending dollars, I think we need to focus them on the problem areas. So the UDC is helping us with that, but I think we need to make some adjustments to make that successful.
Thank you. 1 minute rebuttal.
You know, I think we all know Roswell grew with Greenland that developers came in and pursued, and now we're at that stage where we do have to redevelop. We have no more space to grow, so all we can do is redevelop current somewhat empty shopping centers, somewhat run-down areas. I think it's a good start with the Groveway zoning. I think the UDC is an excellent approach to do this. You know, we haven't even started the public hearings on UDC. Those are going to be coming up over the next 3 or 4 months. So there's a lot to do on the UDC moving forward to get it to its final stage. I've tried personally to meet with developers trying to get that Northwest Quadrant redeveloped off Hope Bridge at 400. When you have three apartment complexes there that are going business, that are cash cows for somebody, you have to create some incentives in order to get someone in to come in, buy the business out, tear them down, and redevelop and build something we need. So it's a fine line to try to create certain incentives in our zoning ordinances. Move forward.
Thank you. Rebuttal or response?
So Jere mentioned that there are some public hearings coming up on the UDC. And we've got, you know, a couple of readings of the UDC, but you know, from my perspective, what I've seen on the website, we actually don't really have any public debate coming up on the UDC. There are opportunities for people to submit their concerns through a forum, and you can reach out to staff on that. But truthfully, we actually need to make some changes right away to ensure that there is public interaction on the UDC. So the other thing that isn't addressed by the UDC, and something that we can consider for improving some of these blighted areas, would be some tax incentives as well. This isn't mentioned in the UDC, but you know, there are opportunities to redevelop some of these shopping areas without going to high density by using some tax incentives. And truthfully, some of these areas might be better as parks. The city might be interested in using some of these properties, so we could create some incentives that way.
Thank you. Please hand the mic to Jere. Jere, your second and last question. The Canton Street District has created a vibrant place for the greater Roswell area. However, those driving in from the surrounding neighborhoods struggle to find parking. Question: how would you create a parking plan that helps create more opportunity for development in this walkable area, but still serve a very vehicle-driven society?
First off, I'd like to comment that we do have public hearings coming up. Unfortunately, some people came to a fifth Monday meeting, which is where the council just listens to citizens on any topic possible, and they thought there was a public meeting, and they were criticizing the council for not responding when we don't normally respond. That's one meeting that we listen. But there are public hearings coming up over the next 4 months on UDC, at City Hall, at council meetings, so that people can come and be heard. And as far as the city buying parks, it kind of reminds me over the years whenever someone didn't want a rezoning right near them, they wanted us to buy the park or buy the land and make it a park. So we could probably have 50% of our city as parkland right now, but I don't think we could afford to take care of it. So there's always a balancing effort on that to try to figure out the cost. And pocket parks cost us even more money to go to because they're small and you have to get to them. As far as parking in the...
Thank you.
Can you repeat the question?
Of course. The Canton Street District has created a vibrant place for the greater Roswell area. However, those driving in from the surrounding neighborhoods struggle to find parking. Question: how would you create a parking plan that helps create more opportunity for development in this walkable area, but still serve a vehicle-friendly, vehicle-driven society?
That's a great question. I'll actually answer that. I'd actually like to see the DDA step up and work on a plan for parking. I know that that is their area, and they've got some nice ideas for Cannon Street, and so I'd really like to see the DDA purchase some land or work with the city on solving that parking problem. Obviously, a parking deck would be nice. There are a few areas around Cannon Street that would be good opportunities for parking. You know, I know with the UDC, we're potentially removing some parking requirements for some of our redevelopment along Cannon Street. That might be some risk. You know, I live near Cannon Street. I actually bought on Prospect Street so I could walk to Cannon Street because there isn't a place to park. And, you know, today we have more demands and we'd like to see more businesses along Cannon Street, but we do need some additional parking. But please, let's work with the DDA.
Jere, one minute, redirect.
Yeah, again, there are some concepts and ideas in place being considered for different parking. Parking garages are very expensive, and I don't see the city doing it by itself. I think it will be part of a bigger redevelopment project with a partnership with private money coming into it. But there are several concepts that have been discussed. So I think moving forward, we will see some issues being solved in that area.
Thank you. Eric, your second and last question. Process transparency and vendor selection is the theme. In January, the council voted on a proposal to replace some of the current grass soccer fields with artificial turf. It has been suggested that the city may have overpaid for these fields. How would you change the vendor selection process to ensure that we always get the most value for our tax dollars and also increase the transparency and rigor with which these proposals are reviewed?
Yeah, that's a great question. I've actually heard that. I guess the response, you know, when people question how expensive the turf was and why we picked the most expensive vendor, I guess the response was that, you know, they would do the best job. And, you know, we've had some samples lately that, you know, when we pick an inexpensive vendor, we have some problems. I guess there's some sidewalks on Highway 9. But, you know, in my experience in the corporate world, you really do need to have more transparency in that process. We need to have more meetings, more discussion that, you know, and present that information to the public. We need to have better criteria that are public for vendors as well. If we're going to pick a high bidder, I think we probably need to go through another public hearing to really prove to the voters and the people of Roswell why we're going to spend the extra money. Because if, you know, I have a choice to pay a lot of money or not pay very much money, I'm usually going to go with low cost. So we should actually prove why we're doing that.
Thank you. Rebuttal.
Definitely I was involved in that since I'm over Parks and Recreation. And I had learned more about artificial turfs than I ever wanted to know. Unfortunately or fortunately. And I told staff, because of the problems I've seen with drainage in Forsyth County, rains would come and their fields would be flooded. I told staff, I want them to do the best job possible, whoever we select. I didn't want any issues with this. I wanted it to last 15 to 20 years. They had interviewed the different vendors. There was a big discrepancy between them from the service standpoint and from checking references. I don't think we need to go in the paper and start telling about a company and their references when we find that they are not up to snuff. That is not what I feel we should do. But I tell you this, that due diligence was done. And I think the staff and the committee that did it made a good decision, and I backed them up.
Thank you. Eric, can you redirect?
Yeah, the only thing I can say is we just need to be more clear on why we're spending more money. I'm fiscally conservative. I want to make sure that we're only spending what we need to spend. And if it means going back to the public and talking with them and showing them why we're doing it, I think we need to do it. Thank you.
Up next, we have Post 6, Nancy Diamond and Kendra Cox. Nancy is going to start with her speech. Want me to repeat the overall themes we'd like you to address?
Sure.
Okay. As part of your answer, we'd like you to address the following. What drives your desire or continued desire for public office? What city projects or initiatives matter to you most? And how will you be more effective on council than your competitor?
First of all, I had no desire to be in public office 5 years ago. I was very engaged in the community for 29 years. Our children have both been raised here and they've now graduated college. They would tell you they grew up in Mayberry, and we feel blessed that they were able to grow up here. And having that opportunity for them was very important to me. As we got older and wanted to downsize, there aren't a lot of options for places to live. We were losing friends of ours to Milton and Alpharetta, still are. Pastor of my church just moved to Milton because there wasn't an empty nester kind of housing for him. So things like that, the housing types, the opportunities that the city was facing, there were a lot of challenges right at the time that I was encouraged to run. But now we're in the middle of a number of things that are really very important and I feel very strongly about. Obviously the UDC is one of them. I've been in the community development liaison and that's been primary in my life. But the branding and marketing campaign I think is hugely important. And I think a lot of times it can be thought of as more of a surface thing, but it is all about how we communicate, how we engage our citizens, how we send the message, and how we speak with a clear, consistent voice to our citizens. And I think that's something that we've been working on, and you know, with the speed of government, we're getting there. The fire station, I am very passionate about. Fire station number 4, we should have done it by now. We had a push to use private property, so that has delayed the process longer than any of us wants, but that's primary in our sights. And I do believe I can be very effective. In 29 years, I have been involved in dozens and dozens of activities in this city. I have made a network of hundreds of people, and I really believe that I have the network and the contacts and the smart people engaged to get things done.
Thank you. Kendra.
Hi, thank you very much. And quick plug, welcome to High Meadows, the most wonderful place on the planet. Our young daughter just started here in the third grade class 3 mornings a week, and so I am extra appreciative to see this school that we've chosen for her has chosen to become so civically involved, and that's really a point of pride. Another point of pride for me is having grown up in Roswell, attended Roswell High School. My husband and I were very lucky to be able to come back here about 3 years ago with our young daughter, and had to live with my parents for a little while we looked for a house, but we were able to find one. I'm sure stories can be told about that. But once we moved into a home and loved it and loved the neighborhood, I started getting involved in local issues. And I was disappointed with the way that the city and the council interacted with residents. When residents would come to the city with a concern or a question, we often felt like nuisances. We felt like we were getting in the way of progress in the process. My career has been in health, in the public and private sector, and I have a great deal of experience working directly with the community, with a community engagement process that works. It's a dialogue, a two-way street. Not an informational meeting where you're invited to come and hear someone talk and then leave, but a real approach that is community-based and rooted in trust and accountability. So I am passionate about being part of this city as we grow, as we redevelop, as my daughter grows up, as I get older, because we're here to stay and I want to be a part of it.
Thank you. We'll stay with you for the first question, Kendra. A communications question. Given some of the recent controversial issues such as the radio tower, water plant, and even the UDC, many have asked for a clear line of communication between the city and its residents. So all have an opportunity to become knowledgeable and involved in civic issues. Question. What would be your approach to ensure citizens feel they are being heard, and what do you think is the key to gaining more civic involvement from the community?
I think the key to gaining more civic involvement in the community is having a process that everyone understands, that everyone trusts, and that everyone can be a part of. The water tank affected me very specifically. It was gonna go behind my neighborhood. And with the water tank and the radio tower, I believe that a process needs to reach out directly to the affected people, ring their doorbell, say, "Hi, I'm from the government and I'm here to help." But really say, "Look, we've got this situation with the roundabout, with the bridge at Oxbow Road at Grimes Bridge. We've got a situation. Something needs to be done. Let's work together and figure out a way to do it and have it all out in the open air. So that this process of public input that is really incorporated and that we're accountable to give the input and the city is accountable for hearing it. It's very hard to engage people because it's a busy time, but it can be done."
Thank you. Rebuttal?
It sounds wonderful. I'd love to be able to do it. I don't know how we could afford staff to ring on doorbells with the hundreds of things that we address on a regular basis. It is a challenge. It is very difficult, and I do think that the branding and marketing effort will include a lot of that and will bring that in. But, you know, the AJC just let go the last reporter in North Fulton. The two newspapers that we have go to less than half our citizens, less than half the people, a third of the people, I think, in Roswell are on Charter cable or any kind of cable, so they don't get our CTV unless they go looking for it online. It's interesting how many people with everything you drive through right now couldn't tell you there's an election next week. So getting the word out is extremely difficult. Getting engagement's even harder. And how do you know which one each person's going to be interested in and how many of those things you do and where that line is and who pays for all that staff to send your message clearly is challenging.
Thank you. Redirect.
I agree that it's challenging, but I think it's worth it, because if it's your priority to truly represent the citizens that you are hired to represent, you're going to make it happen. I've seen it happen in the private sector, and I've seen it happen in the public sector. One benefit to having a lot of networks is using those networks to get the message out. We have very strong HOAs here in Roswell. We have strong civic groups, we have strong professional groups, and so a combination of old-fashioned doorbell ringing, and reaching out through these networks that exist, using social media, using every available tool at our disposal, we can get the message out and help people understand how important it is to be engaged. The apathy and the exhaustion we see among the electorate from the federal level all the way down is disheartening, but it doesn't have to be that way. Because if the people who are elected are trusted, then we can start building back that trust and really have engagement.
Thank you. Nancy, your first question. A number of people have spoken out against the UDC for many reasons. Please provide your vision for what the UDC is and why you feel it is important for the future of Roswell. With the following question and answer: what can be accomplished between now and the first reading of the UDC to ensure concerns are not only heard, but addressed?
I think a lot of the concerns that have already been heard and have already been addressed will be seen in the next draft that comes out, I believe, the 13th of November. We have talked about, you know, the process has been working. We've heard we don't want any more higher buildings. We took out every height in the UDC is as it sits now. We heard the concern about having mixed use and having it in certain areas. Those properties are as they are now, and they'll come through the regular process to apply just like everybody else. I think a lot of the confusion comes from not seeing what's on the ground. I think the assumption is always the developers will do the maximum they can do. The reality is there's places where they can do a lot more now that just haven't happened. So a lot of what you're seeing is already on the ground, and I think that's where, as we go through our next hearings, demonstrating what we have now compared to what we're proposing will make it a lot more clear for people.
Thank you. Rebuttal?
Could you repeat it, please?
Of course.
Thank you.
A number of people have spoken out against the UDC for many reasons. Please provide your vision for what the UDC is and why you feel it is important for the future of Roswell while answering the following question.
What can be accomplished between now and the first reading of the UDC to ensure concerns are not only heard, but addressed?
I think that the UDC has great potential for Roswell because, as has been discussed by several people up here, redevelopment is a huge priority. These strip centers that are empty, that are crying out for really creative new development. And the UDC is one of the ways we can do that. However, we have to make sure that the UDC does exactly what we want. So while we've backed off on some building heights, we're still seeing increased lot coverages. So in the historic district, you're going from 35% lot coverage to 80% lot coverage. And these are concerns that people are raising, concerns about infrastructure. What are we going to do about the traffic when this stuff starts to happen? So between now and the first reading, I have advocated for a public input process that is a dialogue, that is a two-way street, so that when you, a member of the public, make a comment about the UDC, you are acknowledged and responded to, and you see where that goes.
Thank you. Nancy, your redirect?
Yes, I think when you look at what can be accomplished, it's clarity. It's clarity, it's clarity. What we've heard over and over again is we don't know what the rules are. The rules contradict each other. The goal line keeps changing. We do everything they say to do, and then we find some other rule that we didn't know about. That's really the primary purpose of it. And I think you're going to see, as we go through the process, a lot more explanation of that. And the historic district is a misnomer that has been perpetuated. There is a zoning category called RHIST, which is a catchy name for those areas that were around the historic district that weren't actually in the historic district but could be put in there. It's a category that has not been used. No one has taken us up on that offer. It will not be used there. That's where that lot coverage number has come from, and some of the density numbers you're reading about from critics have come from. But the actual lot coverage and density is quite different. And when you look at the parking and green space additional requirements, you'll find it's about an even swap.
Thank you. Kendra, your second and last question. What fresh ideas do you have to grow Roswell's local economy? Do those ideas act in concert with our strategic economic development plan? If so, how, and if not, why not?
The strategic economic development plan is, in some ways, a fairly harsh look at Roswell and what needs to be done. And when I think about growing local business, I think about creating an environment where the strong entrepreneurs that make the city what it is have the tools that they need to accomplish what they need to accomplish. So when you look someplace like Canton Street that has boomed and become such an exciting place to be, that's because those small business owners made it that way. So I see adding more strength to the organizations we have. This group, Roswell Next, I think can be a very big part of coalescing the small business community and generating new ideas and then working with the city to make them happen. And we've seen that in pockets already, but I think we can do it more. And the strategic development plan will support those ideas because it's all about where are we going.
Thank you. Nancy.
I think a lot of this kind of thing is being accomplished by Roswell Inc. and the old Roswell Business Alliance. In less than 2 years, they've facilitated the bringing in of more than 2,400 jobs to Roswell, and that's to fill empty spaces. They've recreated the Restaurant Alliance, who helps them network. You know, more than half of our businesses are home-based. So that networking and that ability to connect with resources is hugely important. We started marketing workshops, free informational sessions on doing business with nonprofits, how they can help boost your bottom line, networking with each other, connecting you to experts in different resources, connecting for different bulk buying and opportunities, and really pulling everybody in one direction. And it has been working, and it is working.
I think that Roswell Inc. is a great example of a public-private partnership where the city can be a part of growth without getting in the way of growth. But I think whenever we consider initiatives like this, we have to be very specific about our measurement. How do we know they're succeeding? So the 2,400 jobs, how many of those were in the works before the Roswell Business Alliance was created? How much did they facilitate it? Because if we don't measure what we're doing, we have no way of figuring out if we're really successful, and we have no way of improving. So whatever we do as a city, as a group, to grow and redevelop and encourage our small businesses, let's measure it. Let's do process and progress outcome measures so that we can really put a thumb on where our money's going and where our efforts are going.
Thank you. Nancy, the final question, final debate question of the evening. Like most metropolitan cities, Roswell is not defined by just one area. Although there are numerous neighborhoods and subdivisions, people are usually referred to by living either on the east or west side of Roswell, or even in the historic district. What would you say are the strongest, most viable traits of each of these three areas? Where can they be strengthened, and how would you see these areas coming together to enhance an overall quality of life?
That's a lot of questions.
It is.
One question. I'm trying to remember here, one minute. West Roswell. I've lived in West Roswell for 29 years, and I've never thought of it as West Roswell. I just thought I lived in Roswell. The historic district absolutely, you know, has its own flair and character, but I think, you know, whether it's East Roswell or West Suburban, really, or the historic district, I think, you know, we look at ourselves as kind of a small town, and I don't know that separating those, while each has a character, I don't know that they represent separate areas at all. I think they all pull together in a very unique way in that, you know, the subdivisions that are pretty much all of West Roswell and a fair amount of East are all very engaged in the schools and the parks and the things that really pull us together. Those kind of things eliminate those boundaries, and Roswell is home regardless of which corner you're in.
Any redirect?
I grew up in what you would call West Roswell, and I worked on the east side at a Mount Asia Fantasy Golf and Games of Roswell. So if in the late 80s you played miniature golf, you're welcome. I feel like each of these areas has unique attributes that can be built up, and particularly in the historic district, one of the things I think we can do is to improve walkability. People move to the historic district because it's really neat, and they choose to be there because of its connection to the parks and the square in Canton Street. So if we can build on our multi-use trails, but also just put in some sidewalks so that the people who live in the historic district can get around, I think that would be a great improvement. East Roswell has the river in a way that the folks in the Northwest may not. And so I think there's an opportunity to really exploit and build on that connection to the river with the parks to coalesce that area.
Thank you. Nancy?
The vision that we came up with after another pretty extensive year and a half long version of public meetings was the vision statement for Roswell, which was to be a premier riverside city connecting strong neighborhoods and the entrepreneurial spirit. And I think that kind of sums up where we want to be. All those parts, you know, the river is our history, that's why we're here. The mill was where we came from, but we're not necessarily focused day to day on our historical side, we're focused on the living side. So I think there's all kinds of areas where you can pull those things together, and that's what our vision and branding and marketing is all about.
Thank you. Now what I'd like to do is open it up to some lighthearted questions. Lightning round, if you will. We'll start with Ken. What is your favorite city, not Roswell?
Wow. I have a lot. the favorite. I really enjoy Seattle because it has all kinds of things out there. It has a lot of things we've been talking about. But it has water, it's got mountains, it has actually really good beer. There are all kinds of things that are out there. But I think it's a live in place. Obviously, it had a lot of high tech. It's a lot of things to do. They've got a lot of the same attributes of sports and other things that are there. But it's very convenient to get to a lot of places. And it's not cold during the winter. It's a temperature. It just rains a little bit, but that's one of my favorites.
Okay. Harvey?
Favorite Roswell restaurant.
Let's see. Well, Jimmy's not here, so I can't say Jimmy's Ray's hamburgers. All right.
Or all of them.
So you're trying to get me in trouble. That's a political answer. Yeah, I think they're all great. Cantry, I love all of them. Jimmy's would probably be number 10 on my list. It is amazing. I mean, and the honest answer is I don't really have a favorite. I discover a new one every day. I met somebody for a cup of coffee the other day on Cann Street and didn't realize, I didn't really know the name of it. I've been there several times, but it's just a great place to go in. And they're all there. We have so many unique different places, but if, I'm kind of partial to Southern cooking. I wish the old skillet would come back, but Table on Main is a good one. But we have several great ones. It's hard to pick just one.
Thank you, Eric. Have you visited the Atlanta Beltline?
I'm sure I have, but didn't know it.
Okay. Jere, what is your favorite thing to do in Roswell?
I mean, Roswell's just a great place to live and raise a family. I love going to the parks. I love going down to the river. You get our bicycles out on the trails. And I'm not talking about the guys that are on the streets running. You know, I'm talking about family bicycling down the trails. It's a lot of fun for that. And then I know my wife likes to go out to the different restaurants to eat. That's one of her favorite things to do in town. We have a lot of wonderful things going on here and events going on at the auditorium. You don't have to go anywhere else. You really don't.
Thank you. Kendra, you've actually answered the question I was going to ask you during your speech, so I'll quickly come up with one.
It was about the mini golf, wasn't it?
Actually, it was. What is the latest or your favorite movie?
We just saw Rush. I'm a huge auto racing fan. I wrote my master's thesis about dirt track auto racing in the South. I am extremely serious about four wheels. And my husband and I actually met as an outgrowth of that. He was helping with the car and love bloomed over a camshaft or whatever. But we went to see Rush and it was just phenomenal. It's about a rivalry in Formula One in the 70s that is iconic. And Ron Howard directed it. So if you've seen Apollo 13, then Rush is like that, only on the ground. But go see it, it's so good.
Thank you. Nancy? I'll ask it a little bit differently. What is the most recent book you read or your favorite book of all time?
Oh, interestingly enough, I'm not so much into auto racing, but it's called The Art of Racing in the Rain. It's an amazing book. Our book club is all over the map, and they're awesome about it that way, and that things that I would never have read, but it's the point of a view of the dog and his family as his wife has cancer, and the whole thing is just amazingly done.
Great, thank you. Well, with that, I'd like to close this out and extend a very warm thank you very much, Candace, for your attention. And last but certainly not least, I would like to thank all of the Roswell Next members or future Roswell Next members that either submitted a question or submitted an idea to make this debate happen. Without your input, which we asked for, and we certainly got it, tonight would not have happened. So thank you very much if you did so.